Then the Lord spoke to Moses.
Speak to the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first day of the month, you shall have a Sabbath rest, a memorial of blowing of trumpets, a holy convocation. You shall do no customary work on it, and you shall offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. Also, the tenth day of this seventh month shall be the Day of Atonement. It shall be a holy convocation for you. You shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. And you shall do no work on that same day, for it is the Day of Atonement, to make atonement for you before the Lord your God.
Welcome to the Day of Atonement. This is God's day, one of the most holy days, and we are fortunate today that we are in the midst of atonement because it lands on Sunday. And this is a day in which, when you begin to study the Bible, that this is probably the holiest day to God. And when the Bible talks about feast, and there are three of them, you will notice in the Bible that the Bible says that God says, these are my feasts. You will read that God says, these are my feasts. He never says they are the feast of the Jews, they are the feast of even the Christian, but these are my feasts. Then you begin to study what feast means, and it means that God makes an appointment with man. We can say in this feast today that God is making an appointment with you today. He's making an appointment. The validity of that appointment and the power of that appointment is so incredible. God works in seasons, and it's so much fun to read God's word and to understand it and to realize that God is a God that, even though that he is magnificent and we cannot find him out, and great is the mystery of godliness, the great thing about it is, when it comes to salvation and when it comes to blessing, God makes it simple enough for us to understand so that we can be blessed. I don't know about you, but I want God's blessings, all of the blessings that I can obtain. When we talk about the Day of Atonement, we have to say that today is the day in which God created man. We have been celebrating the birthday of the earth for the last 5 days. And this is now the sixth day, which is the Day of Atonement. And we have been celebrating and watching and seeing what God is doing. We know that this is a very, 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 very special year. And the fact that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It is no coincidence that in 1948, when you study the Bible, that's when Abraham was born before Christ. He was born 1,948 years before Christ. And then 75 years later, God called him out of Babylon, out of the Chaldeans. And God says, I'm taking you to Canaan's land. I'm taking you, and I'm going to bless you with the promises, and I'm going to make a nation out of you. Isn't it interesting that after Christ died, that Abraham, who is the head of, the Jewish nation, or I should say he's the father of the Jewish nation, he's the father of Islam, all the Arabs, and he's also our father of faith, in which that we are grafted into the family of Abraham when we are born again. And the key is that it is very interesting that in 1948, Israel became a nation. Now it is 75 years later, 2023. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what God's getting ready to do, but he's the same yesterday. He always operates in patterns. 2023 is a moment, and it is a season, is a time in which our expectancy should be very high. Whether Jesus comes back, for this is the time in which Jesus will come back in the next 8 days. We are all in the next 8 days should rejoice and be happy. We've been repenting the last 10 days. We've been seeking God. Praise God for Wednesday night of all the hundreds that were baptized in water. All of the people that came to be anointed. This is a season and a time in which God says, I want to pour double portion. This is also a season in which Satan comes and he is the accuser of the brethren because the books are open today. God makes decisions about your life in the next week, in the next 6 months, and in the next year to come. Because Rosh Hashanah means new year. We are in a new year. We are in the first month. We are in the beginning of God pouring out the former rains and the latter rains. Let me tell you, God's getting ready to pour out some good health. He's getting ready to pour out some good healings. Financial conditions are going to be healed. God is going to open up doors. Favor is going to be upon you. This is a great season. Somebody give God a great big hand clap. This is a great season. So let me tell you how important this is to God. The Day of Atonement was the day in which God, when he made the tabernacle, he told Moses, once a year, I want you to come into the holies of holies. There I will build a special piece of furniture that I want you, Moses, to design and to make. The Bible says that God told Moses that this special piece of furniture, which is called the Ark of the Covenant. He says, once a year, I want you to put it in a holies of holies, in a place that no one else can go in at any other time. And he begins to describe to us and says, the only person that can go in is the high priest, only one high priest. And that high priest was chosen and was Aaron at the time, which is Moses' brother. And God says, I'm going to make atonement. We could use that word atonement in its simplicity. It means at one with him. Say that with me. At one with him. At one with him. And the only way God could redeem us to be at one with him is that there would be the shedding of blood so that our sins would be covered. And so God designed it and said, what I'm going to do when you make a mistake, when sin comes into your life, I'm going to, once a year, I'm going to allow one man to go into the holies of holies. God designed this piece of furniture called the Ark of the Covenant. He designed it in which there would be cherubims that would be facing each other. They would have six wings and they would have four faces. Revelation 4 teaches us and tells us about the four faces that are upon these cherubims. Now these cherubims, which each, they have six wings, and Revelation describes the look of these faces on the cherubim. The first beast was like a lion. The second was like an ox or a calf. And the third was like that of a face of a man, which was the Son of Man. And the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. Now, the reason why the John called them beasts is because if you saw a four-headed creature with six wings, you also would probably say, this is a beast. What is this creature? There is no creature that lives on the earth like this. There is no creature that lives beneath the earth. This creature happens to be in the book of Revelation, if you read the eighth verse. It is next, or it is on the Ark of the Covenant where Jesus is sitting at this time, because he was our mediator, he was our atonement, he was the sacrifice, he was the lamb that gave his life so that we could be at one with him. And these cherubims on our either side of him in a real Ark of the Covenant. And when we go to heaven, you will see Jesus or the throne of God between these huge cherubims. And right now at this moment, these cherubims with four heads and six wings are facing him on the throne of God right now, and Jesus is sitting in the mercy seat, and they are saying, holy, holy. Day and night, the Bible says, that's all they do. These foreheads and the wings are flapping, and you hear these words and you hear this song, holy, holy. Join in with me, everybody, wherever you are. Holy, 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 holy. And that's what's going on at this very moment as I'm speaking. Holy, holy. Because there is a real Ark of the Covenant that is in heaven. And so God designed the smaller Ark of the Covenant and said to Moses, I want you to put it in the tabernacle. And for thousands of years, people would wait as the high priest as they brought lambs and they brought sacrifice, which would be blood sacrifices, and they would give it to the priest and they would wait because they knew that God was atoning for them and that with their sacrifice, their blood sacrifices, the turtle doves they bring, the lambs they would bring, the bullocks that they would bring, the goats that they would bring, the rams that they would bring, that they knew that when he went in, that certain priest, that mediator would go into the holies of holies. He would take the blood, all of the people who had given sacrifice or given the offering, he would mix the blood down and he would cautiously go into the holies of holies. When he went into the holies of holies, he would take and he would sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat between the cherubims. And what he would do is the first sprinkle of the blood, and he would do it with his thumb. He would dip it into the blood and he would sprinkle downward upon the ark. And then he would take and dip in more blood and he would go up six times. On the sixth time, if he did not die, because God said, if I don't accept the people's sacrifice, or I don't accept the offerings and the blood that is sprinkled on the ark, I will then kill the high priest. The people then will know I'm not going to bless them. I am not going to forgive their sin. So that's the reason why they tied ropes upon the legs of the priest, and he would have bells on his garments. And when he would go back into the holies of holies, which was very dark, and the only thing that glowed was the incense that was in the censer and the cup of blood that he took back into the holies of holies, you could barely see as the incense and the glow of the coals that he took from the altars that was put into an incense. And when he got back there, he too was a little nervous and afraid. He would move around where you could hear the bells jingling, jingling, jingling upon his garment. There were ropes tied to his feet, and the other priest would wait outside in the holy place holding on to the ropes, hoping that God would accept the sacrifices and would accept the offerings of the people. And oh, was it a wonderful sight upon that sixth moment that when he sprinkled that blood upon the ark and nothing happened, don't you know he came out of there shouting, saying, God has accepted. The power of the Ark of the Covenant that God was so into symbolizing to let everybody know that he is a God of mercy. The seat of the mercy seat was considered the mercy seat. It had a crown around it. All of you today will be able to see it. In fact, we're privileged to take the symbolic covenant of the Ark of the Covenant, and you will be able to see it. You have the privilege to touch it simply because a new covenant has come, and we are allowed now to touch Jesus, who knows our infirmities and know our problems, and he has taken our place. But the symbolic meaning of atonement and the day of atonement and the judgments that's happening, and this is the time of trumpets. And in the next 8 days, this will be the time of the rapture. Anybody ready to go in the rapture? Anybody looking for him? Anybody looking for Jesus to come? No wonder you've been through all the things you've been through the last 6 to 8 weeks. No wonder there's been the inclement weather and all the things that have happened to our world. Satan is nervous today because he doesn't know what God is going to do. And when that last trump sounds, it's over for the devil, and we, the church, will rise up to meet him in the air. There is a true rapture. It is going to happen, and Jesus has made provision. So when that priest came out, when he came out, he was so excited. The ones holding the ropes, they also were excited. Now, he had to enter into that 3 times. He had to do that on the Day of Atonement. He did it once, sprinkled the blood 7 times, and then came back and did it again 7 times, then came back and did it 7 times. But when that high priest finally did all that God required, it was a wonderful experience to come out. He would get on a white donkey and he would start going down through the tribes of 2 million people, especially in the days of when the tabernacle was in place, and each tribe averaged about 120,000, 130,000. And when that white donkey started down through those tribes and villages and they saw that high priest, that he wasn't dead, that meant that God was going to pour a double portion upon the people. That's when they tore branches off. That's when they put the clothes in front of that donkey and they started celebrating and dancing. I want to tell you today, we need to celebrate the next few days. We need to say, God is good. Great things are going to happen in my life. Double portion is going to take place. The miracles that God is going to do is going to be unbelievable. And if he doesn't come back, then we know that God is going to do great and mighty things with his people. If he comes back, better yet, we're going to live for him and live with him for the rest of our lives. There's some things I want to excite you today about the Day of Atonement that is so thrilling that God puts in to the benefits of understanding the atonement. God wants you to know what he does with you when you draw nigh to atonement, when you come boldly to the throne of grace, when you come to him. God is so symbolic, and he wants you to understand what's going to happen. So one has to think, why the 4 heads on the cherubim? They're going to show you a cherubim angel with 4 heads. Why would God make a creature like this? Why would God make 6 wings, and why would God make 4 heads and all of the heads? These are not busts, but these are lively creatures that are moving, that are operating as an ox and as an eagle and as a lion and as the Son of Man. And this is a creature. In fact, these cherubims, when God cast Adam and Eve out of the garden, the Bible says he put cherubims in the east, or he put them on the east gate to keep them out. These are the most powerful creatures, and yet at the same time, they're the closest to the presence of God, and they are shouting, holy and holy. So you say, why would God do all of that? Because God wants you to note that as you're coming to his presence, he's going to do special things for you. Not only did Jesus Christ come to be our high priest, and he died on the cross, and his blood was good enough. And let me just excite you. Do you remember reading the Bible when the Bible says that when Jesus says it is finished, that the Bible says that the veil was rent from top to bottom? You remember reading that in the Bible, and the Bible says that the veil was rent from top to bottom, meaning that anybody could go in and whatever was in there could come out. In other words, no longer was God going to use man or one mediator or one priest, but was going to open it up that everybody could come into the holies of holies. Anybody excited about coming into the holies of holies? Do you remember when Jesus, when Mary, when he came out of the tomb and she didn't recognize him at first? And the Bible says, I got to shut the smoke off, guys, because I can't see the congregation. This is not the Holy Spirit. This is a mistake in the booth. Either unplug it or take control of it, please. And remember when Mary recognized Jesus, Jesus said these words. You remember reading this in the Bible. He says, don't touch me. I have not yet ascended to my Father. But then you read on, he comes back and tells Thomas, here, put your finger. You don't believe that I had nails in my hands? Put your finger in my scarred hand. And told Thomas, put it in my side where the spear went. How could God say to Mary, don't touch me, and then turn around in a few hours, in a day or so, say, touch me? You have to understand that Jesus, when he said to Mary, don't touch me, I have not yet ascended to my Father. What does that mean? Jesus took his own blood. He went to the real Ark of the Covenant of heaven. He sprinkled his own blood upon the holies of holies. Are you getting this? This is valuable information. He took his blood at Calvary, took his blood where they beat him at the post in Pontius Pilate. And the Bible says when he ascended, what he was telling Mary, don't touch me, because I got to make sure that when I take my blood, I'm going to sprinkle it on the real Ark of the Covenant. And the Bible says that God himself said, it is good, meaning that his blood was better than lamb's blood, goat blood, pigeon blood, ram's blood. And it was the best blood because it was perfect blood that not only could cover your sins, but would remit your sins, that when you ask God to forgive you, he will remember no more. That's worth a hand clap and an amen from every person that's read the Bible. Amen. So now God, you say, Pastor, we don't have to touch the ark. We don't have to go in the holy place. That's true, but the fact is that God has never changed, and God wants you to note that when you come boldly, when you give your offerings, and today we get to touch the ark. None of us are going to die. You know, before Jesus died, if you touched the ark, you would die. You remember they were transporting, you read this part, they were transporting the ark one time, and a priest reached out and tried to adjust it because one of the wheels of the oxen cart went into a pothole. Everybody knows what a pothole is, and the ark was unbalanced, and a priest reached out and touched the ark, and the Bible said it killed him. Well, first of all, they should have never ever put it on a cart, because God said, I want to be carried. There are poles, and I've come down to show you that there is a pole in which God required and said, I want you to run this pole through the ark, and I want you to carry it upon your shoulders, the priest. In other words, God don't want to be driven around. He wants to be on your shoulder. He will never leave you. He will never, you read that. He will never forsake you. And some people want to put God in a cart. They want to put him on a shelf. He's secondary. My social clubs and my busy schedules here, I got to put it on somebody else's shoulder. Preacher, you just preach on Sunday. And you know, I got other things to do. God said, no. I won't be separated. This is at one atonement. I want you to keep me on your shoulder. Anybody got God with you and for you, and I want you to keep you on the shoulder. The Bible says that when you touch that ark, it would kill you today. We can touch the ark, it won't kill you. But let me share with you some things that are about to happen to you on this day. This is the day that God created man. This is, in fact, in 3003, this is very unusual that this weekend that the first temple was dedicated, Solomon, on September 23rd, 3003. That was yesterday. And this is a very special weekend. And when you begin to read of the covenants that God made with Solomon about the temple and the church, and when you make it a house of prayer, all the things that God will do when you come to the house of prayer. And I want to tell you that God has taught us, look, I want you to know that when you come to me, when you come and I redeem you, I got some special things I'm going to do in your life. And he teaches us that through the four heads of the cherubim, because each one of those heads means something. The lion head means something. The bull means something. The head of the bull. And the son of man's face means something. And the eagle means something. Then there are four colors. Did you know that God has four favorite colors? And the colors are, of course, white. And the other color is red. It is red. God loves red. And God loves purple. And God loves, he loves blue. And so when God said, make a veil, I want you to put these colors in front of me. And God says, that's the colors I want. I want white, I want red, I want blue. And so what is he saying to us? He is saying, well, let me tell you that the four heads of the cherubims inside, or the four cherubims right now, that's right now saying holy, holy, and those heads are moving, those creatures, and those six wings are happening upon those cherubims right now. And they're facing Jesus right now. He's sitting on the throne. And when all of us get judged, you will see the big Ark of the Covenant, and you will see him sitting in the mercy seat. Well, what does these colors and the four heads have to do? Because God has symbolized to say, I'm going to do something as you come to my presence. And so he says to Moses, I want you to put four colors. And then God makes the four creatures, or the four heads of the cherubims. And then God says, I'm going to match the colors with the heads of the cherubims, meaning that when you come to God in any given time, whether you're a sinner or you need a miracle or you need a prayer to be answered, first of all, you must come boldly. You can't sit back and wait on God to come to you. You got to come. Somebody shout boldly. It doesn't matter if you're sick. It doesn't matter if you're down in the dumps. It doesn't matter if you're in prison. It doesn't matter if you're addicted. It doesn't matter if you've been through a divorce. You've got to boldly come to the throne. God will not, oh, this is good. You're going to get it. God will not allow you in his presence unless he transforms you. Now, you've been born again, you that believe in Jesus, you've been born again, and he has made you a new creature, which makes you eligible to come into the presence of God. But may I tell you today that as you're coming, when you begin to pray, when you begin to bring your offerings, when you come to his presence, God, the first thing that he will do, he will make an eagle out of you, which represents the blue in the veil. The veil represents the sky. And God doesn't want you to be in your storm through faith when you come to him. He wants you to believe that when you get to him, that he will mount you up with wings like an eagle, and you will fly above the storm. Listen. When you get in the presence of God, you got to throw your Kleenex box away. You got to throw your pity party away. You can't sit there and say, oh me, my mo, you don't know what I'm going through. God expects you to be an eagle flying. The eagle doesn't fly in the storm. He flies above the storm. The second thing that God does every time you pray, and I don't care if you just say Jesus, he does all of these manifestations to you. The Bible describes to us that when you're coming to his presence, he makes an eagle out of you. He puts you in heavenly places. Everybody say Jesus. Just now, he just put you in heavenly places. Right now, you're above. Did you know that serpents and snakes can only go so high in elevation? Oh, can I tell you, God put you above the serpent. He put you above the problem. He put you above the devil. He put you above sickness. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. He lifts you up. The second thing that God does to you, did you know that he makes a lion out of you? That's the reason why there's purple in the veil. Purple. It means royalty. And God can and will not allow you to come into his presence unless there is royalty. But you say, but I'm a sinner. But as you're coming to God, he puts royalty on you. You believe in him, he puts you in right standing. He puts imputed righteousness in your life. The grace comes. And the lion, it represents purple in the veil. And God will not allow you to be in his presence if you're fearful, if you're scared, if you're worried about what somebody has said. God will not allow anybody. He will not allow anybody to be in his presence with fear. You got to stand there with faith so he makes a lion out of you. And I want to declare unto you today that God, when you come to him, he's going to make you a lion. And the lion is the king of the jungle. And you're going to be filled with royalty. Get your head up. It don't matter what the devil or somebody has said. You are a lion of the tribe of Judah. These are God's people. These are God. That's the reason why if you're God's people, you're not afraid to clap your hands. You're a warrior. You're shouting, man. You're not worried about somebody behind you saying, I wonder what they think about me. No, sir. When you're in the battle, you don't think about who's thinking anything. You're in the battle. You're fighting the good fight. You are declaring the glory of the Lord. When you walk into church, you're a lion. And you will notice that there is red in the veil. What does that represent? That represents the bull. Now a bull is not afraid of death. That's the reason why they use him in bull rings. The more they try to kill him, the stronger he becomes to charge into death. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I have a spirit of a bulwark within me. I'm not afraid of COVID. I'm not afraid of cancer. I'm not afraid of diseases. Oh, I'm a bull. I want to tell all of you weak Christians, I love you, but it's time for you to get some bull. I'm not talking about Red Bull. I'm talking about the bull of the Holy Spirit, that you will rise up like a mighty warrior of Christ. You will not compromise. You will not quit your reading the Bible. You will not quit your praying. You will not quit your giving. You will not quit. Oh God, you are mighty. You just charge in. What does the white mean? The white means the purity. It is the face of Jesus who is in the cherubim angel. Now watch what happens as you're coming into the presence of God. You can't put timetables on this, so don't let that mess you up, because no man has seen God at any time. In other words, you can say Jesus and get there as quick as the name of Jesus. There's no going through the stages. But when you get into his presence, you will be full of a lion. You'll be full of a bull. You'll be full of an eagle. And you will have the Son of God and purity, because he puts you in right standing. Not that you're perfect, but Jesus is perfect. And he puts you right in the throne of God, in the throne room. Oh, I want to tell somebody today, something big is about to happen in your life. All of this, guess what? The four colors represent Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You can't get into the book of Acts. You can't get saved, born again, until you've been through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Because each one of them represent the color of the veil, and each one of them represents the spirit of one of those cherubim heads. Oh, let me tell you, don't worry about if you're good enough. Jesus died and said, you're good enough. All I need you to do is come boldly. Boldly pick yourself up and say, enough is enough. I've had it with this credit. I've had it with this debt. I have had it with this situation. I'm coming boldly to the throne of God. That's the reason why rank sinners who don't know anything about God get so bold and say, I believe in you, Lord Jesus. And he pulls them as they're coming in. The Spirit is pulling them, and he's reforming. He's atoning with them. He's changing them. And the blood of Jesus redeems us, sets us free. And the great thing about the blood of Jesus is that when we repent of our sins, he's just and faithful to forgive us of our sins. Somebody shout a great big amen. Deuteronomy and Leviticus are special books, and they are the shadows, they are the types in which God wants us to continue. One of the things that God said, three times a year, I want you to come. And Deuteronomy 16:16, he said, let no man stand before me on these feast days empty-handed. Now that tells me that God has blessed the people of God to have something in their hands. He would never tell anybody to give unless they had something to give. I know that that's the way God operates. The Bible says, especially on the Day of Atonement, which is today, that he says, stand before me and do not stand empty-handed. One must ask, why would God ask me to give an offering? The reason is because money, treasure is in your heart. There's a lot of things about your life, but money, treasures, they're in your heart. To prove that, let somebody break in your house and try to steal your cookie jar of money, and they're messing with your heart. That somebody's tried to cheat you out of your money, and it is close to your heart. The reason why that God said, I want you to bring an offering, is because where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Notice it's in the bloody. Notice it's in the bloody area of your body. Notice he did not say your money was in your brain. Notice he didn't say, your money is in your stomach. He said, it's in your heart. And the only way that you can get anything out of the heart is that you've got to have faith to reach in to pay that bill, to take care of that. Plus, you have worked hard. You've had sweat. You have invested. You have worried. You have made the house payments. The treasure that's in your heart is very valuable. You will also notice that your faith, your confession, it's also in your heart. You will notice in any service, it doesn't matter if it's dead or alive. It doesn't matter if there are 3 people or 3,000 people in the service. You will notice that people can sing and people can greet one another. But let somebody get up and talk about an offering and everybody freezes. Have you ever noticed that? Everybody's feeling great. And all of a sudden, we're going to take up the tithes and offering, and everything gets tight. Can I teach you something? That's when the devil gets up. He don't get up while you're shouting. Because he'll shout with you because he's a good worshiper. The only reason why Satan can be in the midst of God's people is because he knows how to worship. If he didn't know how to worship, he couldn't be there. You remember when the demon-possessed man came out of the tombs and Jesus got out of the boat? What did the Bible say? The Bible said the demon man worshiped him. And then Jesus cast the devil out of him. The only way that Satan could get into the meeting of the sons of God is because he knew how to worship his way. He don't bother you when you worship. And he don't even bother you when I preach. He don't bother you when you sing. And he don't really bother you when you come to the house of God. I'm going to tell you what bothers him. Is that when you decide to reach in your heart and put it on the altar to give to God, he knows that is dangerous. Because he knows that when you give out of the treasures of your heart, it moves the heart of God. And you can't fake it. I said you can't fake it. You can say, I love you, Jesus, hallelujah, run the house, talk in tongues. But if you don't give your offering, you're faking it. You're a hypocrite. Because you don't value God at all. And the excuse to say, I can't afford it, that's a lie. In fact, God made provisions for you to give this offering today, but because you spent it on something else isn't God's fault. Because God is interested in blessing you. He don't want to take anything from you because the accuser of the brethren folds his arms and looks at you and says, they didn't give. They didn't give. And God gets so frustrated because he says, if you would have just given of your heart, then God steps up and points his finger at the adversary and says, back off. In fact, you're going to help me bless them because what you stole from them, you're going to give back to them double, and then I'm going to bless them. And when people say these words, I cannot afford to give, that is a lie from Satan. And I want to tell you today that when you walk on the Day of Atonement and you say, Lord, here's my atonement. What you are doing is you're saying, oh God, I thank you for what you have done for me. There is no way. There is no way we could pay him back. There is no way that we could even get even with what he did for us. Atoning our sins. But when we come and we bring him the offering, by the way, I want to tell you, this is not a heaven or hell issue. If you don't do it, it doesn't mean you'll go to hell. You just go to heaven broke. There's a lot of broke people in the kingdom. They gripe about how broke they are. They gripe they don't have this. They gripe about their bodies, their health, etc. And you can still go to heaven because you've been born again. So don't complain about being broke. and not a good health. You cast that upon yourself. But God has made a provision to say, if you come and you give me the treasure of your heart, I will do things that will confound you. I will bless you like you have never been blessed before. And the reason why people are not where they could be is because they've been hesitant, they're afraid. And they think that God is taking something from them when God is trying to get something to you. But God doesn't believe until you reach into your heart. So Satan gets up at the offering time and he does everything he can to try to stop you from giving. He also gets up at altar call time because the only thing that moves the heart to come to God is his presence. And he always works at altar call time. It's time to quit. We got to go. Hey, we got to get to eat here. Okay, we better finish. Quick, preacher. Hurry. Because Satan does not want you to give your heart. But today I'm excited to tell you, it is the Day of Atonement. God said to come and stand before me. And I want to tell you, there will be multiple, before the sun goes down tonight, which will be the end of atonement, I want to tell you there will be multiple blessings. That the storm you've been through, it's going to be finished. God is about to raise you up like you have never been raised. Your bills are about to be paid. God's about to do something in your health. God's getting ready to bless your family. That addiction is going to be broken. And it is a wonderful thing to give. So today what I am doing is honoring God. For he has said, come on the Day of Atonement and bring me an offering and do not stand empty-handed. It's an offering in which you should say, this is significant. This is an offering, God, you will be moved by because it moves me. It is not a regular, but it is something, God, substantial. And I want to say, in just a moment when the veil goes up, you'll get to touch the ark. If you're a guest today, please join in row by row. You may not have been taught to give, and I want you to still come and touch the ark. I want the virtue of the ark. I want it to move you. For the first time in the history of our atonement offering, we have three arks. I was able, through Dr. Terry Harmon, to get two more arks. There are arks in the third floor or in the balcony area, and they are secluded. And the balcony will be able to touch the Ark of the Covenant as we that are here. And when we come, we will lay our offerings, and everyone, guests, everyone come. We have a memorial gift we want to give you, but the greatest thing is that God is going to bless you. God is going to pour out his spirit. God is going to do mighty things in your life. So let us unveil the Ark of the Covenant and visualize Jesus sitting between, and visualize there's a big Ark of the Covenant, and visualize they're saying, holy, holy, holy. Unveil the Ark of the Covenant. is something that you have created that is very, very special. Lord, as we have anointed handkerchiefs and we send them out as Apostle Paul did, and there was virtue for healing. Lord, as the people touch the ark and they bring their atonement offerings, Lord, let the virtue of your presence of the four colors, the four heads of the cherubim angel and the Holy Spirit, as they come today, Lord, let there be a mighty outpouring of the great presence of God, a double portion upon all. And may victory before the sun goes down tonight be written in their house and upon their lives. In the name of Jesus, we come, here we come, God, to bring our atonement offering. For you in the balcony, they're going to tell you how the first row to go out. You'll go out on either side. You'll make a circle. You'll touch the ark and give the offering. They will get your gift. You that are underneath the balcony in the very back on the main floor, they're asking you now to stand up and to come down to the front. There'll be two this section. You'll come down the same aisle. And these two sections, you'll come down the same aisle, cascade in just a moment. You will come. Come now, everyone. And in the balcony, start moving in the lines as we all come and give our atonement offering. Have your phones. If you have your phones, bring your phones. Let the phones touch the ark. All phones. You touch the ark.
No!
Everybody standing in this moment of blessing on the Day of Atonement, as the conclusion of the offering is being laid, I take the east balcony and I put yours upon the ark. I know you've touched the ark. And then the west balcony, I take your offerings. And everybody say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For being my atonement.
For being my atonement.
This is so precious. I think you should give everybody a hand clap for being obedient to God. Every offering is very important. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, mighty God. I will pray the seven blessings upon. When the sun goes down today, everyone should be prepared for double portion. Whatever you've been going through, the devil is a liar, and it ends today on the Day of Atonement. The Lord decides to come back. How many is ready to go? I said, how many is ready to go? Father, we lift up this offering. This is nothing but obedience. We have done your will. And on the Day of Atonement, one of the special days that's special to you, I ask you, oh God, and everyone's got your hands lifted, let the blessings, let the double portion, let your families, let restoration, let healing, let favor, let healing come upon your life. And in the name of Jesus Christ, everyone say, oh God,
oh God,
we give this to you today.
We give this to you today.
Receive it now.
Receive it now.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
How many can get excited about what God is getting ready to do? You don't want to miss Wednesday night. We got a prophet going to be here Wednesday night. Good things are about to happen to you. You need to walk out of here and say, the blessings of the Lord are upon me, and walk out of here with a shout. And if the Lord doesn't come this week, I'll see you Wednesday night or Sunday. God bless you. Go and get your miracles.
The Day of Atonement. The people came and they gave and put it on the Ark of the Covenant. We had three Ark of the Covenants today. We had two in the balcony, out in the halls of people marched, and then we had the main one you saw, which was at the altar. And today, as the people came and they gave the atonement offering, God said, three times a year, I want you to come and do not stand empty-handed. God says to us, stand before me and put an offering in both hands and offer it to me. And the people did. They brought their phones, they gave by phones, they gave by envelopes, they gave by checks, they gave. If you have not given, you can do that right now. We put it right on the ark. There is a special blessing. We lift it up to God. And I will tell you, probably the most powerful miracles I have heard is when people give the atonement offering. Today you heard the message about David. You heard about he tried not to give it. And the sword of the Lord came and killed 10,000 men. It wasn't until David gave the atonement offering that the bleeding stopped, the problem stopped. You have a problem, something going on, you're making decisions. Is the enemy wrestling with your mind? What's going on in your life? The enemy's trying to destroy. But when you stand before the Lord with one of the most powerful weapons, the atonement offering, he cannot accuse you. I'm excited today because the people gave. You're giving. Lord, I put the blessings, I pronounce the blessings of the atonement offering upon the people. I bless them in the name of Jesus. And today, Lord, let the double portion come in every area of their life. Well, this is what I'm going to say to you, because next Sunday, I possibly could not be here. Or they may rerun a tape. It's possible that you and I will not be here. We will vanish sometime this week. If the Lord comes, it will happen in the twinkling of an eye, fifth of a second, and we will vanish from the earth. It will be this week, because the Bible says this is the week of Sukkot, where they built booths and huts and went out and celebrated and had parties and food and was excited because they were looking up for the redemption draw of nine. The Bible says, unto them that look for him shall he appear. If you're not looking for him, he will not be coming back for you. But you look up. If it is to be, it will be this week. We have repented for 10 days. We have given the atonement offering. We have sanctified ourselves. Now, if he is to come, praise God, we receive it. Let me tell you, folks, you're hearing it from this shepherd. It boggles my imagination. I just learned this. I didn't know this in all the years that I've lived. And I did not know that Abraham was born in 1948 before Christ. And then in 2023 before Christ, God called him out of Babylon, which is a type of a rapture. Did you know in 1948 after Christ came, Israel became a nation? That's Abraham who is the head of that nation. Do you know it's 2023? You can't make this up. What is about to happen to the planet? God's about to call us out. Oh, be ready. Be full of expectancy. God's going to do mighty things. And remember, a double portion. If the Lord don't come back, great things are going to happen to us because we prepared ourselves for it. But if he does, we say, come on and come quickly, Lord Jesus, as John said in Revelations. God bless you, and be anointed, be healed. And if we don't have the rapture this week, Wednesday night's going to be exciting. And Sunday will be exciting. But if the rapture takes place, I'll see you in heaven. God bless you, and have a glorious Atonement Day.